Heavenly Father, we now come to this place where we open your word. And Lord, in one sense, I wish we were going through a different passage of Scripture. This is a difficult word, Lord. It's a condemnation of false teachers. It's a warning to the church to resist and reject false teachers, to know their description, Lord, to understand their ways so that we can identify them and avoid them, Lord. I wish in one sense we were dealing with something else, but this is where we're at right now in your word, and we receive it and accept it. Pray that, God, you will instruct us through it this morning and encourage our hearts to stay in your word, to stay in your truth, to not leave that foundation. And we pray this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen, amen. Amen. Well, again, good morning, and welcome to Calvary Chapel, Quincy, California. Turn with me in your Bibles this morning to the book of Jude. The book of Jude, it's the second book, the second to the last book in your Bible, just before the book of Revelation. And as I mentioned, we're in the Christmas season, and I kind of wish we were doing something easier. But here we are. Here we are. And again, Jude is a book of only one chapter. It contains only 25 verses. But it's a powerful, powerful book with a powerful, powerful message. And this, again, is a book that goes hand in hand with the book of 2 Peter, which we just finished a few weeks ago. The people that Peter warned us we're coming, Jude says, they're already here. And in fact, not were they already here in Jude's day, but they are still here today. The theme of the book of Jude is contend for the faith. Contend for the faith. And as Jude began to write this epistle, he wanted to write something regarding our common salvation, right? Common is that Greek word koinonia. It's what we have in common. It's Christ. It's the foundation of our faith. He wanted to write something about that, but the Holy Spirit redirected him. He found it necessary to write to us to contend for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. In fact, that's our key verse, verse 3. He says, beloved, talking to you, talking to saints, you are the beloved of God. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. Now, for many churches today, this is a call to re-Bible, that is, to return to the foundations of the faith. In Jude's day, it was to hang on, to fight, to contend earnestly for the faith. But today's call is a call to re-Bible, to get back to the foundation of the faith, get back to the Word of God as the only standard for our faith and practice. Amen?
Amen.
That's our standard. It's not what culture says. It's not what society says. God's word is our standard for faith and practice. So if you're not already there, turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Jude. Starting in verse 5, we went over verses 1 through 4 last week. And if you missed that series, you can pick us up, as Jim mentioned, on YouTube or our audio off our website. We also have CDs in the sound booth. But we'll start and pick up the study in verse 5 as Jude begins to describe the judgments of God in the past so that we can be certain that God will judge false teachers in the future. Look at verse 5. But I want to remind you, though you once knew this, that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who did not believe. Jude now gives us three groups of people, three examples out of the Old Testament that demonstrate that God indeed will judge. He will also give us three examples of individuals that God also judged in the past, that these false teachers today are like these individuals. And these examples are to remind you, it says, though you once knew this. Many of you know the stories of the Bible. You know these things. But most of you, just like the people Jude wrote to, are leaky vessels. God's word goes in, but over time it leaks out if we don't constantly refresh that well. And as we learned in our study through 2 Peter, we need to be reminded over and over again of the foundational truths of Scripture. We have an enemy who cast doubt upon the Word of God, just like he did with Eve in the Garden of Eden, where he said, did God really say? Yes, he did. Yes, he did. And that's where we stand on the Word of God. What God has said, not what society says, not what the culture around us would say, but what God would say. Don't believe the lies of the enemy. Believe what God has said. So we need to be reminded. This first reminder comes from the book of Numbers, chapter 14. God brought the children of Israel out of Egypt through the desert to a place called Kadesh Barnea. It was on the border of the promised land. They sent spies in to check out the land. It was a land flowing with milk and honey, just like the Lord had said. Many people sit in church. They hear about the promised land, heaven. They hear that it is land that's going to be filled with milk and honey. There's a sweetness to what's coming. But they truly never believe. They hear it, but they don't believe. And because of unbelief, they never enter in to the promised land. Well, that's what happened to Israel. That's the example. They sent spies in to check out the land. And again, it was a land flowing with milk and honey. It was a wonderful place to be, just as God had promised them. But there was one problem. Along the way, there were some difficulties. There were some battles to be fought. There were giants in the land. Giants. And then, by the way, that's what that means. Giants. And even after all the miracles they had seen and the promises that God had given them of that land, they refused to believe that God would give them the strength to defeat the giants and take the land. It was a lack of faith on their part. And that lack of faith was because they did not believe. They truly did not believe. And as a result, they suffered judgment. It says God afterward destroyed those who did not believe. Now it took another 38 years wandering in the deserts for all of those unbelievers to die before their children would go in and inherit the promised land. And similarly, even though it seems as if false teachers are prospering now, their day will come when God will judge them because they do not believe. Let me say that again. They do not believe. Jude said in verse 4, he said, they deny the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. They're not believers at all, but they are unbelievers. You can't deny God and our Lord Jesus Christ and be a believer. It's as simple as that. Amen. But they're within the church. Satan found out thousands of years ago that if you can't defeat them, join them. And so he has infiltrated the church with false believers, masquerading as believers, and leading people astray. Paul said it this way. He said, they teach doctrines of devils. In other words, they're teaching the lies of Satan and not the truth of God. That's a danger. And those people, unfortunately, and we'll talk about this in a bit, they are now in positions of leadership and authority within some of the major denominations of churches, which were formerly great, sound Bible-teaching churches, but now have strayed from the Word of God because false teachers have come in the side door, infiltrated, and arose to positions of power and authority. Look at verse 6 now, another example. And the angels who did not keep their proper domain, but left their own abode, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of that great day. So not only did God judge his people, and among the congregation of Israel, there were believers and there were unbelievers. And God weeded out the unbelievers, but not only did God judge them, but God will also judge angelic beings, those who rebelled, those who joined Satan in his rebellion. And he did so in the past. This verse here is a reference to Genesis chapter 6, where we find some of the strangest stuff in Scripture. It says there in Genesis 6 that the sons of God, that's always, by the way, a reference to angels in the Scripture, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men. Daughters of men, those are speaking about human beings. So now we have two groups of people. We've got angelic people and we've got human people. So the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful. And they took wives for themselves of all whom they chose. Now, we don't completely understand how this was possible, how this worked. It's strange. But Scripture clearly says that it was possible and says that it did in fact happen. And the results of that unholy union were twofold. Number one, it says in Genesis 6, it says there were giants on the earth in those days. That's where the giants came from, by the way. And it says, on the earth in those days and also afterward. That's after the flood. So this happened again after the flood. That's where Goliath and his brothers, Og, king of Bashan, that's where they came from. So there were giants on the earth in those days and also afterward when the sons of God came into the daughters of men and they bore children to them. So giants were the results of angelic DNA mixing with human DNA. And I got to tell you, that's strange. That's some weird stuff. The Bible says it happened. Now the second result was that this mixing of DNA was so widespread that by the time of Noah, it says in Genesis 6, 9, that Noah was a just man, perfect in his generations. What this means is that Noah was potentially, Noah and his family, potentially the only people unaffected or uninfected by angelic DNA. It says that Noah was perfect in his generations. That word means whole or complete. It may be that Noah and his family were the only people left with a whole and complete human DNA. See? So it was widespread. And again, this was Satan's plan to prevent the Messiah from coming. If I can infect all of humanity in this way, then the Messiah cannot come. Because these angelic beings did not keep their proper domain, but left their own abode. They left heaven for earth. They rebelled. God has reserved them in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of that great day. And Jude's point here is that if God will judge these great and mighty angelic beings, he will likewise judge false teachers. These angelic beings are held in chains. They're awaiting their judgment. They're in darkness. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be in darkness. I like the light. False teachers will likewise one day be judged. It is a certainty. If God judged among the congregation of Israel, and if God judged angelic beings, then God will judge false teachers who are unbelievers. Now look at our third example, verse 7. As Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them in a similar manner to these, having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Now this third example we ought to all be familiar with. God judged the civilizations of Sodom and Gomorrah for widespread homosexuality. That's what this means. You can read about it for yourself in Genesis chapter 19. It says here that they gave themselves over to sexual immorality and that they went after strange flesh. It also says that they're set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. They suffered fire and brimstone as a civilization and were destroyed physically from the earth, but they will also suffer the vengeance of eternal fire. Their judgment will be for all eternity. And what these three examples demonstrate for us is that God will judge those among his people who are not true believers, especially false teachers. They might enjoy fame and fortune here and now, but in the hereafter they will one day suffer the vengeance of eternal fire. These are examples. I mean, we think God is asleep. We think God is an absent landowner. He's not. In fact, the Bible says, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. You can be sure God's watching over Israel right now. Amen. In their conflict. Look at verse 8 now as we get a description of these false teachers. Likewise, just like Sodom and Gomorrah, just like rebellious angels, and just like the unbelievers among the congregation of Israel, just like that, likewise, also these dreamers defile the flesh, reject authority, and speak evil of dignitaries. Jude calls these false teachers dreamers. They're dreamers because they do not live in reality. That is the reality of God. They live in a dreamland. They live in a world of their own imagination apart from God's truth, which they have rejected. It says that they defile the flesh. In other words, they are living in immorality, just like the people of Sodom and Gomorrah, just like the fallen angelic beings. They're living in immorality. And many, many of these false teachers, unfortunately, now hold leadership positions in some of the formerly great churches and denominations in our country and across the world. They are currently, and you can find this even in this town, even in this county, they are currently embracing the homosexual agenda and the alphabet soup of gender dysphoria. They embrace that. They put up the flag. They celebrate it. They invite it. They support it. These are unbelievers. These are dreamers who defile the flesh. They reject God's truth, and they dream up their own version of the truth. They're just like the world around them. God has called us, the church, to be holy. That word holy means to be separate. Separate from sin. Society may say it's okay to sin in that way. God says it's not. Who are you going to believe? Who are you going to follow? Society that changes? I mean, give it another 10 years, they're going to be into something else. Maybe something worse than what they're into now. Because when you reject God as our society has done, when you say no to God, you begin to descend further and further away from truth, away from the light, into darkness. And your society begins to reflect that darkness. And that's what we're seeing today. Crime, homelessness, homosexuality, drug abuse, drunkenness, people living and laying on the streets in our major cities, people confused about their own gender, their identity, people pushing this stuff down onto our children in school. That's the result of a society that has said no to God. So these are dreamers, dreaming up their own version of the truth, which is really darkness. Secondly, it says they reject authority. They reject the authority of God's word. And instead they dream up their own authority. In Jude's day, it also meant they rejected the authority of the apostles. Later in this chapter, Jude will mention the rebellion of Korah. Korah challenged Moses' authority. You see, they reject God's authority, but they also reject those whom God has appointed to positions of authority. Okay? They reject the authority that God has put in the church for the safety of the church, the shepherds to feed the flock, to care for the flock, and to protect the flock. They reject that authority. Third, they speak evil of dignitaries. So not only do they reject authority, but they speak out against God's authority and God's appointed authorities. It's one thing to personally reject authority, and it's another thing to speak out openly against authority. In other words, to lead rebellion against authority. We'll read about this later. They're grumblers and complainers, right? They're vocalizing their objection to God and his authority. Look at verse 9. Yet Michael, the archangel, there's only one. That means first angel. There's not a bunch of them. There's one. Yet Michael, the archangel, in contending with the devil, when he disputed about the body of Moses, dared not bring against him, that is against the devil, a reviling accusation, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." So even the leader of the angelic beings, Michael the archangel, even he did not speak evil of dignitaries, even the devil. Instead, when he disputed with the devil about the body of Moses, he didn't run him down. He didn't cuss him out. He just said, "The Lord rebuke you." He turned it over to the Lord. "The Lord rebuke you." Now, Jude is sort of famous for bringing up, and we'll see another one later, bringing up these obscure and strange passages of Scripture. Apparently, according to a lost book of which we have only fragments today, called the Assumption of Moses, there was an argument about the body of Moses when he died. The devil wanted the body. I think he wanted it in order to turn it into an idol so that people would worship Moses. The other thing he could have been doing is trying to prevent the bodily return of Moses, because Moses showed up at the Mount of Transfiguration along with Elijah when Jesus was transformed into his glory. And I think, and many do, that Moses will be one of the two witnesses who return to earth during the tribulation period to preach the gospel. So he wanted that body of Moses in order to prevent that. But the lesson here is that if Michael the archangel didn't speak evil of dignitaries, then neither should we. Amen? And this is a little extra on this point. What business do we little men and women have rebuking Satan? I hear Christians say this all the time. I rebuke you, Satan. Michael didn't do that. He said the Lord rebuke you. And how about binding Satan? You hear Christians say this all the time. I bind you. If Christians are always binding Satan, I want to know who lets him loose. Right? If he's bound, then how is he still out there running around? How does he get loose from being bound? We should never rebuke Satan or bind him, but say, the Lord rebuke you. In other words, turn it over to the Lord. Amen? Amen. Put Jesus between you and the enemy. Amen. But these, look at verse 10. But these, speaking of these false teachers, but these speak evil of whatever they do not know. And whatever they know naturally, like brute beasts, in these things they corrupt themselves. Because false teachers are not born again, they do not have the Spirit of God, and so they can only act in an instinctual way, naturally, like an animal, like a brute beast. They can't even think in a spiritual way. Now, they can think and act in a religious way, and many of them do. That's how they get into churches, acting religious. But they cannot truly act and think in a spiritual way because they do not have the Spirit of God. Jude says, these speak evil of whatever they do not know. They don't know or understand spiritual things. Paul said it this way. He said, the natural man, that is the man who is not born again, whose spirit has not been regenerated by God, the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. So these false teachers can't know and understand spiritual things. Paul goes on to say, by way of contrast, speaking of believers, he says, but we who believe, have the mind of Christ. So we who are born again can know and understand these things because we have the mind of Christ. They, however, can only act in an instinctual, natural way like an animal. An animal acts on instinct. Right now, we see the birds, the geese, the ducks, they're flying south for the winter. It's not because they're smarter than us. It's because they are instinctual. By instinct, they are moving on, right? That's all they can do is act on instinct. They can't think it through. They can't figure out how to make a coat. Neither can Cliff. Where is he at? I'm joking about these guys that I have known over the years work for UPS, right? Even in the winter, they're wearing shorts. They can get some pants on, dude. All right, all that aside, look at verse 11. Woe to them, for they have gone in the way of Cain, have run greedily in the error of Balaam for profit, and perished in the rebellion of Korah. So Jude pronounces woe, woe to them. That's a pronouncement of judgment, coming judgment. There's a woe coming upon these men and women. And he gives three examples of individuals that describe what false teachers are like. First of all, as we've already mentioned over and over, because Jude and Peter mention it, they are unbelievers. It says they have gone in the way of Cain. Cain's way was the way of unbelief, which ultimately led to the murder of his own brother Abel. Cain lacked genuine faith. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 4, it says, by faith, Abel, that's Cain's brother, by faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. So why was Abel's sacrifice more excellent than Cain's? Because it was offered in faith. He truly believed. Cain's offering was simply religious. He went through the religious motions to make an offering to God, but he really didn't believe. You see, that's the difference. By faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice. So the way of Cain is the way of unbelief. False teachers are described as unbelievers who deny the Lord God and our only Lord Jesus Christ. They are unbelievers. Secondly, it says they have run greedily in the error of Balaam. This means they're in it for the money. Back in 2 Peter, he said that they want to exploit you by covetousness. Balaam was a prophet, but he was a greedy prophet. We read his story in Numbers 22 through 25. Also, if you jump to Numbers 31, you find out that God judged Balaam and he died. Well, King Balak of the Moabites hired Balaam to curse Israel as they were coming through his land to the promised land. Balaam attempted to curse Israel, but God would not allow him. So I think it was four times he blessed Israel instead of cursing him. But he still wanted the money that King Balak offered him. And so he gave Balak counsel. He said, you know, I can't curse Israel, but if you send your ladies over there to hook up with their guys, they will lead them astray into idolatry and God will judge them. That's exactly what happened. And 25,000 of the children of Israel perished because of that. Well, Balaam did that out of greed. He wanted to be paid. And false teachers are no different. They're in it for the money, plain and simple. Thirdly, Jude compares them to the rebellion of Korah. Korah's story is found in Numbers chapter 16. He said to him, he said, congregation is holy. The Lord is among them. Why then do you exalt yourself above the congregation of the Lord? Korah and his followers were guilty of rebellion. God had appointed Moses to lead the children of Israel. But they rebelled against God's appointed authority. False teachers today similarly reject God's authority and God's appointed authorities. And each one of these individuals, these three individuals, Cain, Balaam, and Korah, suffered the judgment of God. And the lesson is that God will judge these false teachers, each and every one of them. In verse 12, it says, "These are spots in your love feasts, while they feast with you without fear, serving only themselves." We're going to stop right there at verse 12 and pick up the second half of it in a moment. Well, the early church often got together to share a common meal, a love feast, much like our potluck lunch that we have once a month on Communion Sunday. Well, these false teachers are described as spots in your love feast. They're like flies in the ointment. They kind of spoil the whole thing. And look how they behave. It says here, serving only themselves. They weren't there to serve others, but to serve only themselves. For some in the early church, these love feasts were the only good meal they got. But instead of serving others, these false teachers served only themselves. I assume they got in the potluck line first and filled their plate up, and people at the end of the line had nothing. In other words, this describes them as being selfish. Their motive is selfishness. In that way, they were a spot or a blemish in those love feasts. Now look at the rest of verse 12 and verse 13. "They are clouds without water, carried about by the winds, late autumn trees without fruit, twice dead, pulled up by the roots, raging waves of the sea, foaming up their own shame, wandering stars for whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever." False teachers don't bring any real spiritual value to the church. They promise the world but deliver nothing of any real spiritual value. I think of those late night preacher infomercials where they hawk holy water or holy cloth. If you will only send them your hard-earned dollars, they promise to send you healing water or a little piece of healing cloth. They are clouds without water, trees without fruit, raging waves of the sea, wandering stars. God will judge them severely. It says, wandering stars, for whom is reserved, check it out, the blackness of darkness forever. That's not a good place to be. It's pitch black. You're in hell. You're being burned up by the flames. You're being eaten up by the worms. You can't see a thing. All you can feel is misery for all eternity. That's the place God has reserved for these. Now Enoch, verse 14, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men. So he talked about them, saying, "Behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment on all, to convict all who are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have committed in a ungodly way, and of all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him." In these two verses, the word ungodly jumps out. It's used four times to describe false teachers and their followers, by the way. Not only are false teachers without God, but they are nothing like God. They are ungodly. They don't represent God. And they're, in fact, ungodly in their deeds, what they do, the deeds which they have committed in an ungodly way. And they're also ungodly in their words. It says, all of the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. So they're convicted by their deeds and they're convicted by their words. Now, just so you're not confused, the fact that Jude quotes from an ancient book attributed to Enoch, who shows up in Scripture in a brief passage from Genesis chapter 5, does not mean that the entire book of Enoch is inspired. It was not accepted by the Jews as Scripture, and it was not accepted by the church as Scripture. But this section, pulled from the book of Enoch, has indeed found its way into the inspired Word of God. So for all intents and purposes, this portion of the book of Enoch is inspired, while the whole was not. So as far back as Enoch, the seventh person from Adam, God has promised to execute judgment on all the ungodly, and especially these false teachers described here. We already saw the example. Enoch spoke about it. God actually did it with the flood of Noah. And God will do it again. Amen? He will judge again. Now look at a little further description, our last verse, of these false teachers. These are grumblers, complainers, walking according to their own lusts. And they mouth great, swelling words, flattering people to gain advantage. So here we have additional description describing these false teachers. Not only are they not submitted to the authority of God or the authority of the local church, but they complain and gripe about that authority. These are grumblers, complainers, walking according to their own lusts. You get the picture. They're in church. They're among you. They came in the side door. Pretty soon they're dissatisfied. They're starting to talk. They're starting to grumble. They're starting to complain. That indicates they're talking to other people too, right? They're gathering a group, right? Oh, yeah, I don't like what the pastor did, and I don't like what this fella did, and pretty soon, they've got a little crew going on, a little rebellion going on. They reject God's authority, and they reject those whom God has put in positions of authority. They're grumblers and complaining. And in addition to their griping and complaining, it says they mouth great swelling words. They talk a good game, right? It says flattering people to gain advantage. Boy, they butter you up. They butter you up. Beware of those people who flatter you and yet grumble and complain about the church and its leadership. Beware of them. And that's not to say, by the way, that church leadership is always right, okay? That doesn't imply that I'm always right. But when someone doesn't come to me personally to tell me where I'm wrong, but begins to gather a group around them to grumble and to complain and to start a rebellion, that's a false teacher. That's someone you need to be aware of and stay away from. Amen? Even though they flatter you, even though they wine and dine you, even though they butter you up, they may just have an ulterior motive. Unfortunately, as I have mentioned already, the church is under attack by Satan through false teachers who have snuck in through the side door and brought in damnable heresies, denying the Lord who bought them. Even denying the Lord who bought them. Christ paid the price for them, and yet they deny that. Most of the formerly great Christian denominations and churches have been infected by these false teachers who bring in liberal theology, whose focus is on man and not on Christ. These religious charlatans have turned great churches into nothing more than a mirror image of the culture and society of the world around them. As Jude has already said, he said, woe to them. Woe to them. But what are we to do? What then are we to do? We are to hold on firmly to the Word of God as our only standard, our only rule for faith and practice. Amen? Amen. That's where we get our standard. Our standard is not society. Our standard is not culture. Our standard is the Word of God alone. Amen. God will deal with false teachers. We already read it, right? We just read that God is going to deal with them. Their judgment is certain. But we must be aware of them, reject them, and hold on firmly to the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
And again, as we conclude today, I want to remind you that the best defense against false teachers and false doctrine is to know the truth of the Word of God. And the only way that we will know the truth of the Word of God is by reading it. Read your Bibles. Read your Bible every day. And you will know the truth. Jesus said, and the truth will set you free. Okay? Know God's truth, and you will be protected against false teachers and false doctrine. You will recognize it when it comes your way. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray, and we'll have the worship team come back up for one final song. Heavenly Father, once again, this is a powerful, powerful section of Scripture. It's a powerful warning to us to stay true to your word, to stand firm on your word, to know your word and order our lives by your word, to walk in the light of its truth. Help us to do so, Lord, so that we might not be led away by the error of the wicked. And we pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.
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 Praise God for the objective truth of his word that we have to base all of our lives on. Let's go ahead and stand. We're going to sing about the objective truth. Jesus Christ, who himself said, I am the way and the truth and the life. I don't think Mary understood that when she gave birth to him on that Christmas morn, but we do now, so let's sing about him.
Did you know that your baby boy would someday walk on water? Mary, did you know that your your baby boy would save our sons and daughters. Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you deliver will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will kiss eye to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with his hand? Did you know
Savior, who showed while he was on earth that he was the Lord of all creation, that he did things that no mere man could have done. He was the Lord God, the creator of all. And he came, he died for our sins, he rose again on the third day, and he is coming back, and we look forward to that day. So Lord, as we're dismissed and we celebrate this Christmas season, may we celebrate our Lord and Savior. Thank you for all that you've done. May we be lights to this world and hold dearly and closely to the truth of your word that this world denies and marginalizes and does all sorts of terrible things to. May we proclaim that truth to a generation that so desperately needs it. And Lord, as we're dismissed and we think of, we say our goodbyes to Daniel and Jody, we pray that you would give them safe travels and great blessing down as they go down to Southern California and great time of adjustment and reunion with family. Bless them, Lord, again, as was prayed. We're so thankful that they were able to be a part of our church, in some cases months and in some cases years. Thank you for them, Lord. Pray all these things now. And commit this time to you in your son's name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Don't please say goodbye and give your love to Daniel and Jody.
Yes. I was thinking that.